Hello, in this video tutorial I'm going to explain how to create a block building game in a single sitting. The chunks will be saved as text files. This tutorial will not contain Perlin noise or marching tubes. I will have one script for the player character and I will also have one script for the building procedure of the chunks. And this will be basically the whole game. Playing the game, you will be able to manipulate the meshes of the chunks by digging in holes or adding cubes. We have here the possibility of adding three different textured cubes. I think you get the picture, so let's start. At the beginning, let me mention some videos as sources I was inspired by producing this video. I got inspired by the character controller of Brackeys, and I also learned how to write and read TXT files from those two videos here. At the beginning, we create a folder called StreamingAssets in the Assets folder. The naming is important because this is a special folder which will contain assets which are able to be manipulated in the build version later on. We are creating a layer called ground, and I put this layer on the 10th position. You are able to choose the cell you are writing this word ground in, but keep in mind if you are changing the position, you will have to later on also change the parts in the code. I already prepared a user interface, a panel, and it contains a text field which will be regularly updated, and I also have a crosshair picture, a crosshair sprite in the center of my screen which helps me aiming later on. I created an empty game object just to have something where I drag the main script, the most important script, onto. I also created an empty game object called player. The naming is important because I'm referring it later on by name. I also put the player controller script onto that empty game object, and I couldn't manage to define the grounding mask by script, so I have to manually set here ground at this component. Other components of the player will be created by script at the initialization. Okay. We also got a camera at the beginning of the scene, and considering this all, we can start by viewing the script of the player. In this version of the character controller script, I took all important parts of the script and put them into one single file. And this script also, at the very beginning, in the very first frame, initializes the player. That means that all main important components are being built in the very first frame by this particular script. However, I couldn't manage to set the layer mask at the integer value number 10, So I had to define it in the Unity editor, but the other parts of the character controller are being adjusted within this script here. And this was the most important part here. So if you go back into the scene and play the preview, you will notice that the player object will have additional objects like the capsule representing the player. The capsule created by script here also has a collider, and we are destroying this component because we do not need additional colliders in the scene. And it also has a ground check of player object, which will help us to notify us if we are touching the ground. And depending on the distance to the ground, we are able to jump or not to jump. In the preview mode, we see the new components of the player. We see how the main camera became a child of the player. And we see the character controller component. Now, if I hide the body of the character and have a look at a certain angle, I see the green capsule of this character controller. And the values of this character controller are modified by the script. Because I want to lock my mouse in the middle of the screen, I add this line here at the beginning. While playing in the preview mode, we noticed that there are more and more TXT files in the streaming asset folder, and depending on the position my player is, those files become eventually more. Because every time I'm entering an area I've never been before with this log files, it is creating a new TXT file. I know that this is not a good concept, and there are way better concepts, like having maybe a database inside of Unity, but this was the approach I choose because I just wanted to make something like a prototype, and it works well enough for this prototype. For the main script building those chunks, we have to assign a texture file, and also the game object displaying the text on the display. Having assigned the texture file and the display object, we are able to have a look at the probably most important script here. Okay, let's have a look. What was I thinking here? Current building mode gives us the mode we are right now in the building procedure. That means if this value is a zero, I am walking around with a pickaxe and digging holes. If this value is a 1, I am building bricks, which kind of bricks is not given specifically here, but I am building bricks and I am manipulating the meshes of the chunks. In the future, there could be additional values like value 2, where I'm setting game objects like coins, or I'm planting plants, and those objects wouldn't or are not allowed, should be something I'm able to walk through, but the chunks have a specific collider where I'm not allowed to walk through, and here in this example I'm using only those two modes. Active chunks enumeration is the area where all chunks within this specific scene are stored in. If I'm going far away of specific chunks, they are being destroyed and their association will be deleted in this area. And if I'm visiting areas which are new, new chunks will be created, and those new created chunks will be put in the very first free cell of this specific area. At the very first run of this script, I'm telling the program which shader to use. I am using the Manhattan norm to give something similar like a radius for the area. I'd like the chunks to appear around the player. Depending on this so-called radius, I have to set the length of the area containing all chunks which will be within this scene. So script builds the very first chunk. At this point, I think it wouldn't be needed because it will be built automatically later on. However, the script also needs to know where the player object is, and I'm assigning the player object here at the very end. Let's have a look at the beginning of the update procedure. We are taking the position of the player, and we also need to know the position of the player in relation to the chunk he is on. Most lines at the beginning here are responsible for the general user interface. I have here 4 slots for the building icons, and item menu, menu type tells me what kind of item is being displayed. I have only 2 options, the 0 for the digging mode and the 1 for the building mode of bricks. Within the digging mode, I have only 1 option, which is also a 0, because this one single option is a pickaxe. But if I'm in item menu mode number 1, I have multiple bricks I could choose from. I have brick number 1, I have brick number 2, and I have brick number 3. And those are my very first 4 possibilities I could choose from what to do. This part here is interesting. I'm sending out something like a laser beam, and I am getting my response. I'm getting the values of what's being hit. I get the information of what layer the game object which was hit was on. I am getting the information of the position of the game object which was just hit by this laser beam. I am also getting the information which object was hit by this ray. If I am targeting a useful game object, I'm getting realistic values. However, if I'm looking into the sky or on a game object which isn't important, I get a minus one as a placeholder back. Now, if I am in the digging mode and I am targeting a object on layer number 10, which is my ground layer, the layer where the chunks are on, and if I am pushing my left mouse button, if I am holding my left mouse button, I am in this part of my script here, and I get also important informations now, which I need for digging a hole. At first I need the impact position of my ray, which I get here, but I also need the integer value of the position where I want to be a hole. The interesting part is here, I'm using a round function and it is interesting to see here that I have to subtract 0.5 in order to get the integer value to get the right number of the cube on each coordinate. And also what is important to know at this example here is I am able to target at a specific polygon, but the script does not know which of both cubes I am targeting at. Do I want to have the cube with the blue surrounding, or do I want to have the cube with the orange surrounding in this sketch here? And because I am in the digging mode, because I'm in mode 0, I do want to have the filled cube with earth. Here I want the cube with the blue surrounding, and in order to have a value where I do not have problems with the rounding function, I have to extend my ray a little bit into this cube after already hitting the polygon. So I just take the point where I hit my mesh and I go a little bit further into the mesh with my slightly extended vector, and now the rounding function gives me the integer position of the cube I want to delete. And now if I was targeting the very same part of my chunk for more than 1 second, the function update chunk txt gets executed. Now if I am targeting the very same polygon for more than 1 second, I am executing the update chunk txt function, which will build my new cube. In this example, however, I am deleting this specific cube, and this means I do not even need also informations to send within this function, but I have to write something in as a placeholder. I designed this function in order to be expandable in the future. However, here are just a few parts which exist but are not really needed. Okay, now let's have a look on what's going to happen if I want to add a part to this chunk. This part looks quite similar. The main difference is I'm now in building mode number one because I want to add bricks, and this time I am not extending the ray into the mesh, but I am going a little step backwards. I'm going a little bit towards the camera, and I'm using the same code again, and this time I also transmit the kind of stone I'm going to build in the update chunk txt function. And now at the very end of the update procedure, we are checking if the environment around our player has changed. We use here the update Umgebungschunks function. I'm sorry, I forgot to translate this part. Let's have a close look on that function. It goes through the whole area which is containing the chunks. If we find a chunk within this area which is far away from the player, this specific chunk gets deleted. It gets destroyed from the scene, but after destroying the game object, we also have to clear the cell of the area because the area itself does not save the game object. It only saves the reference number to the specific game object. And later on in this script, we are regularly going through this area and searching for empty positions which we want to fill with new chunks later on. Here now we are going through the surroundings of the player. Depending on the player position, we are going two chunks from the left, two chunks to the right, and two chunks from the front to two chunks to the back. And every time we have one of these positions, we are checking if this specific chunk already exists in the area. And at the end of this part of the loop, we have the information telling us if this chunk exists or does not exist. And if it does not exist, because we are in a very new surrounding, we are creating this chunk with a function build chunk mesh. We do not need to save this very new chunk into the area because we have within our new function called here build chunk mesh a very own part which will update the already existing chunk area. with the function called updateChunkTxt. We are updating the txt file containing the informations about this specific chunk. We are updating our save game information, and at the beginning we are checking if this specific chunk already is loaded in the game, in the scene, and we are checking if it already is in the chunk area. If it is in the chunk area, we are deleting the game object and we are deleting the reference within the area for the very same reasons explained before. And now we are creating something like a placeholder once we have the three-dimensional integer area, which has three coordinates, x, y, and z. And in this example, I decided to make the chunks have a width of 16 blocks and a height of 256 blocks. I see here should be a 16 at the beginning, but this doesn't matter here. And later on, here we see that the typical values of these chunks are 0 if the cubes are above the level of 100. If they are below the level of 100, the typical value, the typical integer value is a 1, because all cubes below this high, below this level, are regularly Earth. And in the future we are only saving information which is different from this usual cube. Now we are starting to read the already existing txt file line by line, and we are getting this new informations from each line, and we are updating our area with those informations so that we have the most updated version in the script. The user could be able to manipulate the values within the txt document, and for this specific reason I made a error notification if there are some values which are negative. Of course I would also need a error if the values are higher than 16 in this case here, but in the end, I don't care. And now, at this specific point, we are manipulating the one information we have new at this point. And this overrides the one part of the already existing three-dimensional integer area. Having now our updated three-dimensional integer area, we are once more reading out each cell of this three-dimensional area, and each time we get a value which is different from our usual chunk, we are saving this information as a line in the txt document. Having updated this specific save game file concerning this specific chunk, we also want to see the updated version of this chunk in the game. We want to see the very new mesh which we just manipulated. For this reason we have to call the function buildChunkMesh, which is basically just updating this specific chunk. Also important to mention is that if we are editing cubes being near the border of the chunk, we could cause problems because we could make adjustments so that holes appear. And in order to make sure that no holes in this continuous mesh appear, we need to also update the neighbors. And in the original version, I had a if and else if functions in it, but then I also noticed if I am updating a small block in a very corner of this chunk, I have to update multiply neighbors at once, and instead of thinking, I just put this these for function here, these if statements, and I just update the very specific meshes. Now we are finally creating the mesh of our new game object. The name of the chunk we want to create, or let's say update, is saved as a vector to integer. I am quite sure there does exist a more professional way. There does exist a way which is professional. However, like before, we are once more destroying the old game object from the active chunks enumeration area. At this point here, we also have to consider the possibility that this txt file does not exist at all, because we have never been near this area. In such a scenario, we have to create the very first txt file. And just for fun, I decided to put a cube in the middle of our very new chunk, which we are creating here. And this little cube helps us to orientate and see how many chunks are being loaded, and it has the coordinates as follows. The x position is 6, the y position is 106, and the z position is also 6. The kind of stone is earth. This means it has the number 1, and with this line of code we have just written and saved the first chunk save file concerning this position. You can ignore the string array here because it was an option for future upcoming options, which I'm not implementing here. So the only important part is a three-dimensional integer array. And like I mentioned before, the important information here is that this specific integer array has a height of 17 blocks and not 16 blocks, because we are building a chunk which has only 16 blocks, but we also need the information of the 17th row in order to know what kind of polygons to build. Like before, we created a three-dimensional array of integer values, and we are reading the txt file concerning our specific chunk we are viewing at this moment, and we are reading out each line of this txt file. We are getting the new information of each line and putting this new information, this new brick type, into our three-dimensional integer array, so that the computer knows all important information. The already existing three-dimensional integer array is mostly filled with all relevant information, but we also have to fill the cells which are on the 17th line each. That means we have once to read out the whole txt file of the chunk which is on the east side of our specific chunk, and we have once to read out all lines of the chunk which is one position going north of our chunk. For this reason, we have only to read out the lines with the C1 position having the index 0, and this value gets into the 17th line of our main chunk we are viewing right now. But remember, the counting at arrays starts at the value 0, so the 16 here is in reality our 17th. Now we have to do the very same procedure with the chunk once on the north side, but this time we are reading out the information where the z coordinate is a 0 and putting it in the 17th line also. And now we are finally building our mesh. If this game object does not already exist, we are creating it. We are adding a mesh renderer. We are selecting our mesh. We are allowing it to have 2000 vertices. I'm quite sure this should be depending on the number of cubes which are manually added or subtracted from the original mesh, but in our example I think it's still working. And finally, we are going to create vertices, UVs and triangles. Those are the three arrays we have to create in order to see the new game object. Vertices are the three-dimensional positions of the points of the object. In this example is the point P1 and the point P4 at the very same position, but we have to view them as separate points, but both have the very same coordinates. While these vertices are three-dimensional vectors. We also have two-dimensional UV vectors, which help us to identify the position on a two-dimensional texture. Each of these three-dimensional vertices has a two-dimensional vector describing the point on a two-dimensional texture. So the length of the vertices array has the very same value as the length of the UV array. The values of the two-dimensional UV vector usually go between 0 and 1 because it is in relation to the length of the texture. However, in a repeating mode of the texture, which you would have to configure in the scene, you would be able to go outside of those boundaries. The triangle array has integer values and always three continuous values create a polygon, and the value of the triangle cells represent the position of the vertex from above. So the length of the triangle array always has to be divisible by 3. If it is not divisible by 3, I think there could even be an error message in Unity. The order within a group of 3 of those indexes is relevant. However, the order of those groups of 3 inside this triangles array is not relevant. Now we are having a look at each cube within this chunk, and we are always looking if we do have to build a wall toward the east, and we are looking if we have to build a wall toward the north, and we are looking if we have to build a wall towards above. As an example given here, we see if we have to build a wall on the right side. In the next loop, we are having a look if we have to build the wall looking to the left side or looking to the right side, depending which part is air and which part is filled with earth, or let's say which part has a non-zero value. Here at the beginning we see that our current brick has a value of 0, and the brick on the right side has a value of not 0. This means this part is filled. This means we have to build a wall on the right side, and the normal vector has to look to the left side. Now we know that the brick on the right side is filled, and we are looking if the brick above this specific brick on the right side does exist. If it does exist, we know that we have to take the middle texture. If it does not exist, we know that the brick on the right side is a top brick, and we have to take the top texture for this specific brick. And in the next step, we are checking which kind of brick we have. Is it a earth brick? Is it a sand brick? Or is it a concrete brick? Depending on this integer value, we have different UV positions for the textures. All other cases, all other directions we have to consider have the very same principle. And for this reason, I'm just having a quick look at those scenarios. I'd like to mention at this part that I like to enumerate the quad number because this makes life easy later on using the indexes. Here for this example, I'm able to take the quad number and multiply it by 4 or by 6 depending on which area I'm modifying at the moment. And I always add just a number like plus 0, plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, plus 4, plus 5. And I always have the very same construction tree each time. And I just have to add the value of 1 each time I have built one of those quads. And now we are at the very end of creating those quads because we have considered each cube within our chunk. In order to prevent bugs, we are clearing the mesh and we are adding our new vertices to the mesh. We are adding our new triangles to the mesh and we are adding our new UVs to the mesh. We are also adding our texture to the mesh. And finally, we are recalculating normals and recalculate bounds, which I'm not sure why exactly it is useful for. However, at the end, we are giving this specific game object our ground information. We add this game object to the layer ground and we also have to add a mesh collider to this game object in order for us to be able to walk on this game object. It is important that this is a mesh collider and not a box collider, as an example. And finally, we are positioning this just built game object at the right position. And as a very last step, we are saving this chunk in the very first free cell of our array containing all the chunks within this specific scene. In this example, the function is giving out the game object. However, in the script, the output is not needed. So we could also write a void above and not write the line with return here, but it's quite the same in my eyes, and we are finished. I forgot to delete the very last function here. This function was helping me reading the information out of the TXT files, and it was converting a position into a three-dimensional vector. but we can ignore and also delete this one. Let's have a final look of our game within the Unity preview. I see how everything is being created with the information out of the TXT files. New chunks are being created and new text files are being saved. And within the very last minute of recording, I discovered a bug. If you are building on polygons which have a horizontal normal vector and also are right on the border, the new upcoming brick will be positioned 16 blocks ahead. This could be an error with the modulo operator, but I don't even care at this point. I call it a day, and thank you for watching.